Welcome into our second edition of the Lakers Nation NBA Draft Podcast. I am your host, Serena Winters, and once again, we have Corey Hansford, one of our senior writers and college hoops experts, joining us today. So thank you guys for all of your feedback after our first podcast. It's really because of you guys we decided to keep this going, but this time we're going to focus on five guys the Lakers should consider with their picks at 27 and 34. Now, our first podcast centered around the top five prospects the Lakers could draft if the Lakers land their top five protected pick on May 19th, but unfortunately, as we all know, there is a chance the Lakers fall out of the top five, in which case, at least the Lakers still have those picks at 27 and 34. If you're wondering where that late first round pick came from at 27, remember when the Lakers acquired Jeremy Lin in their trade with Houston this past summer? The Lakers also acquired Houston's pick, so in that trade, happened to wind up at 27 this season. So the Lakers could be in a good spot here with two draft picks. Remember last year, the Lakers got a gem, Jordan Clarkson at 46. So this is where we bring in Corey Hansford to give us five underrated and realistic prospects that the Lakers should seriously consider taking at 27 and 34. And if you're thinking, okay, well, who could the Lakers really get at 27 and 34 that would make a difference? Remember, there are plenty of great young players in the league today that were taken at that range. I mean, we're talking Rudy Gobert, 27th, Jimmy Butler, 30th, Hassan Whiteside, 33rd, Draymond Green, 35th, even Chandler Parsons, 38th. So there's definitely some hope. So Corey, without further ado, who is the number one underrated guy on your radar right now in terms of the Lakers having those picks at 27 and 34?
My underrated guy, and he's almost starting to get on other people's radar lately, but I am very, very high on Tyler Harvey. He's a small school guy out of Eastern Washington, and he's drawn some comparisons, very, very light comparisons. Don't want to overdo it, but he's drawn some comparisons to Steph Curry. He's a undersized 6'4", 181, very thin guy. But at Eastern Washington, he took 9.6 threes a game, but he shot them at a 41% clip, which is absolutely outstanding. And you think in Eastern Washington, he's the only guy there. He's who the defenses are focusing on. And despite that, to shoot that high of a percentage at 23 points a game and only average two turnovers a game as well. So he's not reckless. He's a very high IQ guy. I think at worst, he could be someone like a Ben Gordon, who's a spark plug off the bench, something of that nature. But I definitely think Tyler Harvey is someone to watch out for. And Byron Scott always said that the Lakers didn't take that many threes because they didn't have shooters. And that's not an excuse anymore if you get someone like Harvey.
And if you guys have heard that name before, it might be because I remember with ESPN's Chad Ford, when he came out with that grade A mock draft, I know that he grabbed him for the Lakers. So if you guys have heard him before, that might be one of the reasons why. Corey, do you think there will be any good enough point guards at that range that are left that the Lakers should consider drafting even though they have Jordan Clarkson?
Well, absolutely. There's a couple of guys in that range. There's a Brazilian guy, George Lucas DePaula, who's gotten a lot of attention because of his measurements and his wingspan and hand size. But the one that I particularly like is DeLon Wright from Utah. He's got good size, 6'5 and a half. He's a little bit thin, but he's a really, really solid all-around point guard. I liken him to Sean Livingston, who in his younger days was one of the top point guard prospects. Great height, very good court vision, not the greatest shooter, but defensively Wright is very, very strong on that end. He's great with getting in the passing lanes, averaged two steals a game at Utah. As far as going up and down the floor and really, really hounding opposing point guards, that's something that he can do. And for as good and as athletic as Clarkson was, defense wasn't necessarily his best point at times last year. And Wright can give teams a different look on that end. And he's someone that he was second team All-American last year. He can play, but he's a little bit older, and so people tend to pick apart his game a little bit more, and that's what happened to him. But he's definitely someone to consider.
Sure, yeah, and like you said, he is one of the older guys this year at 23 years old. Now, obviously, the Lakers have a lot of needs, right?
Oh, yes.
But they are seriously lacking in the bigs department. So who do you have for me there?
I'm looking forward to seeing how Christian Wood comes. He's from UNLV, and he's probably the least likely to drop to the 27th pick, but it is definitely a possibility. He's got great size. He's 6'10 and a half. He's got a 7'3" wingspan. He's a great shot blocker. He's a very good rebounder. And his best offensive trait is the perimeter. He's a great 15-foot shooter and is even dabbled with going back to the three-point line, so possibly even a stretch four, but retaining the rebounding and the rim protection that you need. The worry with him is that his post-game, back-to-the-basket game, isn't quite up to par yet. And he's only 216 pounds, so he needs to fill out his body a little more. He can get pushed around a little bit. He's similar. I almost combined him to a couple of Lakers last year, almost a combination of Ed Davis and Jordan Hill. He can give you the rebounding and the rim protection of Davis, but he's more of a perimeter-based big like Jordan Hill was and can almost fall in love with it like we saw Hill do. But as far as upside and someone who can really grow, Wood is one of the bigs there who can definitely give something for the Lakers, if not immediately, at the very least a couple years down the line.
At the combine, his wingspan was 7'3", 25 inches. But I will also say that he did come in with a 14.7% body fat. So that is worrisome to me in multiple areas, also just as far as conditioning-wise.
Yes.
What about another big?
And speaking of the body fat, the guy who had the highest body fat at the combine was Dakari Johnson.
Yep.
And but he's someone who kind of got lost in the shuffle. You're at Kentucky, you got Karl Anthony Towns, you got Cauley Stein, you got Trey Lyles. There's Dakari Johnson who's there, and he's not someone who's going to be a star, and he's probably not even someone who projects to be a starter, but he can be that very, very solid backup big man, almost similar to how Nazi Muhammad has been in the last few years of his deal. He may not always be the person that you turn to, but you know he's going to be ready and he's going to go out there and he's going to do his job. He is a 7-footer, 6'11 and 3 quarters. We'll round it up to 7 feet. But, you know, 7'2 wingspan. He's 264 pounds. He's not going to be pushed around. And, you know, Robert Sacre has been complained about for a long time by Lakers fans almost since he's been here. He's someone who can basically be a better version of what Sacre has been. For the Lakers, he doesn't offer the upside of, say, someone like a Robert Upshaw, but he's a lot safer and a little more reliable, can give you what you need on a night-to-night basis.
I will say something else that worries me a little bit with him is he doesn't seem like one of the best rim protectors either at that size.
But that is a worry.
Well, with the start of free agency really creeping away, we're coming up on 6 weeks here. I mean, Wes Johnson's going to be a free agent, and as of right now, I can't really see a situation where the Lakers and Wes work something out for him to stay. Who do you have for me there in kind of a Wes role?
And it's funny because someone who's been mentioned recently in free agency talks with the Lakers has been Damari Carroll, and I think someone who, in the draft, who is very similar to him is Justin Anderson from Virginia, and he's one of the best on-ball defenders. He's an NBA-ready body, 230 pounds, 6'6", muscular, very quick lateral movement. And the worry on him was his shooting going into his junior season. But in his junior season, he shot 45% from three. Now, the worry is that was that a one-year thing, or is that something that can be consistently put together at the NBA three-point range? But he's a role player, and he knows his role. He's going to defend. He's going to rebound well. He's going to bring energy, toughness. And the Lakers haven't had that at the wing position basically since the Meta World Peace first year. And Anderson is someone who can step in. He's got a 6'11 wingspan, even though he's only 6'6". So that kind of makes up for a slight undersize at the small forward spot. But he's got all the tools you need for the guys who can stretch the floor as well as defend his position.
Sure. You know, I would actually be a little surprised, I think, Corey, if he was still there at 27. I think that he'll go sooner than that. But, hey, we'll see. Well, thank you so much. Before we leave you guys today, I promised you guys on Twitter that we'd be answering some of your questions on today's podcast, and we got a lot of great questions. So let's get to it. This one is from DeMarcus Montreal. Corey, should the Lakers take a chance on Robert Upshaw, who you actually just mentioned? the troubled but talented center from Washington. And if you guys don't know out there, Upshaw was kicked off the team at Fresno State and at Washington. So that's what he means by troubled.
He worries me a little bit. The talent is undeniable. He averaged 4.5 blocks in only 25 minutes at Washington. It's ridiculous numbers. He's a legit 7-footer. He's mobile. He's agile. He can move. He's got a couple of decent offensive moves, a decent hook shot. I mean, the talent is there. He was a late lottery guy and probably playing higher until he got kicked off of Washington. After what the Lakers dealt with Andrew Bynum and how that turned out, it's what scares me a little bit. Where we know the talent is there, but is the talent going to be enough to outweigh the possible troubles that he could get into and that would make him a long-term answer at center? He's definitely worth the risk at 34, but at 27, depending on who's there, I'm not sure if I take him over someone who can give close to that talent, but with less of the mental risk. Because I almost think he's someone to like a young Andrew Bogut, who before his injuries was one of the best young bigs, mm-hmm. and while he wasn't the best scorer, can rebound, block shots. But the mental aspect for Upshaw really scares me. At 34, I think he's definitely worth it. But at 27, I'm not sure if some of the other guys we talked about before are there.
Okay. This one is from @Phileast17 on Twitter. Do you think Mitch might try to trade the 27th and 34th picks to get a higher pick or to get a player? And then a related question from Dominic T, who's @ThisOneDomGuy on Twitter. Do you think the Lakers can package both picks for a higher seed, or is that not wise, even if they could? Before you answer, Corey, I will first off say that I do know Mitch Kupchak likes the players in this year's draft. He definitely does. So I know that the Lakers are definitely looking at that talent. But go ahead and answer that.
Absolutely. I think it's a possibility, but it depends on who falls and how the draft plays out. If someone who was supposed to be in the late lottery, the early teens, the 14 to 17 range, is suddenly there at 21, 22, it's definitely worth it to trade up both picks to get someone like, say, a R.J. Hunter, if he was to fall that far, which I don't think he will, but someone like that, if the team really has their eye on someone like that. You saw it last year with Rodney Hood, who was projected to be a late lottery guy, and he falls all the way to 22 with Utah. Something like that, I think the Lakers would look at it, but it just depends on how the draft plays out and who falls and who rises, and you never quite know how things are going to turn out. But the Lakers, you know, while they aren't going to rush a rebuild, they do want to get guys who are going to be contributors immediately. And it's hard to do that with so many young guys when you're talking about already having Clarkson and Randall and Tarik Black and then possibly three other rookies. It's a lot of development, and I'm not sure they'd want to have that much youth as opposed to getting a couple more established guys or making one better player as opposed to two guys who you're not sure about. So I think they'll look at it depending on how it falls out.
Okay, not too much time left here, but this one is from Twitter handle @JD06Mens. Could LA acquire an additional first round pick?
They could if they're willing to give up something that right. Lakers fans probably don't want to give up.
Exactly.
The 34th pick isn't enough to really move into the first round. And the tradable guys, people like Jordan Hill or Nick Young, aren't enough to really push that over the edge. So unless the Lakers are giving up Jordan Clarkson or Julius Randle, I don't think they're going to be able to get another first-round pick on top of the second one that they already have.
And one more. Sean on Twitter, @SHAU_Zoe. What positions are we targeting, and will the Harrison twins drop this far? I'll answer the first part as far as what positions they are targeting. All positions, Sean. They are targeting all of them. But Corey, could you possibly see the Harrison twins dropping?
I don't think the Harrison twins are really a target at that range. Most of the things that I've seen have the Harrison twins in the 40s mm-hmm. to the 50s and possibly even undrafted. At 34, there's plenty of other guys who are looked at as better NBA prospects or international guys who could be stashed away for a year or two. The Harrisons have been solid college players, but even still inconsistent college players. And while the Lakers may look at them, they would have to play their way up into the 34 range or the end of the first round ranges. Right now, they're looked at as late second round picks.
Alrighty, that's all the time we have for today, and that's going to do it for our second edition of our Lakers Nation Draft Podcast. Remember, if you want to keep these up, hit the like button and leave some feedback for us in the comment section. I know some people have asked us to do a podcast on realistic free agents, so we'll definitely be considering that as well as many more. So make sure to follow us on Twitter, myself at Serena Winters and Corey at TheCoreyH, and thanks for listening.